This is the Santa Cruz Megatower, a 160mm 29er with a VPP suspension design that is supposedly built to winch uphill and bomb downhill. But what exactly makes the VPP suspension any good? And is it worth the price, or all just hype? In this video, I'm going to be doing another in-depth suspension analysis to figure out if you're paying for the name or an amazing suspension. The one thing that Santa Cruz says about their suspension is that their kinematics can be finely tuned to ensure pedaling efficiency as well as excellent bump absorption. So let's start by looking at the anti-rise and anti-squat of the system, which represents the suspension response during braking and acceleration. If you have no idea what these are or how they are calculated, make sure to check out my previous video by clicking in the top right. Much like in that video, I will once again draw a line from the front contact patch vertically and a horizontal line from the center of gravity of the rider until they intersect, representing the 100% anti-rise or anti-squat point. However, unlike last time, I'm going to be analyzing the two parameters at multiple points through the travel for a better understanding of what makes the VPP a little more unique. At the beginning of the travel, the anti-rise is actually higher than that of the Scott Ransom, at 89%, resulting in the weight transfer affecting the suspension less during braking. At 25% sag, the anti-rise still remains higher at around 76%. However, as you get deeper in the travel, the anti-rise keeps dropping to well below that of the Ransom. Fully compressed, the Ransom achieves an anti-rise of around 40%, while the Megatower achieves an anti-rise in the negatives. So what does this mean for the Megatower? Well, it means that for most braking situations, the bike will resist the back end rising and keep the bike more level when compared to the Ransom, which is a good thing. However, when you drop off something huge and then apply brakes, it is likely that the suspension will extend a lot and won't counteract the weight transfer of the rider at all. An unfortunate side effect of the suspension design, or a purposeful design feature? I'm not exactly sure without talking to one of the Santa Cruz engineers. Moving on to anti-squat, this is an area where the VPP suspension definitely seems to shine. The anti-squat numbers remain above or very near 100% during the first half of its travel, and then only start decreasing once you get closer to 60% travel. But at this point, it's unlikely that you're pedaling, so it doesn't really matter that it decreases. All this means is that the suspension is definitely going to pedal excellently, with very little to no pedal bob. Now that we've looked at the braking and pedaling characteristics, it's important to look at the kinematics and forces imparted on the suspension by the rear shock. What is very interesting with this bike is that it comes stock with an air shock, but also has the option for a coil shock. Why does this matter? Well, air shocks are inherently more progressive, so if you design the suspension for an air shock, the linkage mechanism and subsequent leverage ratio is likely to be more linear and rely on the air shock progressiveness to prevent bottom out. But if you put on a coil shock, now you have a linear leverage ratio and a linear spring rate, and it's likely that you're going to blow through the travel pretty quick or have a very harsh ride due to needing a higher spring rate coil to prevent bottom out. Let's jump into the numbers and see if Santa Cruz addresses this problem. Much like for the Ransom, the Megatower VPP leverage ratio also decreases as you go through the travel, resulting in a progressive design that gets harder to compress the shock the further you get in its travel, and apparently also helps with a poppy feeling of a ride. However, there are two notable things with this curve. Firstly, the overall leverage ratio is higher for the Megatower compared to the Ransom, which only has a range from about 3 to 2.4. This leads to the need for a bigger spring or higher pressures in the Megatower shock for the same weight rider, resulting in slightly worse small bump compliance. Another thing to note is that the leverage ratio starts to flatten out deep in the travel, and actually starts increasing a small amount during the last 10% of its travel. I'll touch on this more in a bit, but the long and short is this is not of concern. Combining the leverage ratio due to the frame design with the spring rate of the shock results in an overall suspension wheel rate that looks like this for an air shock, which also happens to be almost identical to that of the Ransom. Turns out the spring rate has a much larger effect on the wheel rate than the leverage ratio, as a result of the relatively small change in suspension leverage ratio from 3.5 to 2.7 compared to the large change in spring rate as the shock goes through its travel. This lack of difference between the two bikes' suspension responses despite having different leverage ratio curves explains why the slightly increasing leverage ratio in the last 10% of the Megatower's travel is not of concern. However, this doesn't mean that the leverage ratio has no effect at all, as seen when you compare the wheel rate for a coil shock to a perfectly linear rate. As you will notice, the wheel rate has a slight progressive response, which is only going to be helped further with the flip chip on the Megatower that supposedly increases the progressivity of the suspension setup further. Having said that, you will still only likely go coil because you have consistent terrain and are looking for a more supple response from small hits and are willing to sacrifice the big hit bottom-out performance. My overall conclusion with all of this analysis is that the Ransom and the Megatower with an air shock should, surprisingly, feel almost identical when looking at the suspension force response alone. The last thing to quickly cover is the wheel path and the chain growth for the Megatower. Much like the Ransom, the Megatower follows an almost vertical wheel path with just a very slight rear movement at first before starting to arc forward deeper in the travel. The Megatower, however, arcs a little bit more, resulting in a chain growth of only 23mm or 5.2%, compared to the Ransom's 27.5mm or roughly 6.3%. What this means is that the square edge hit performance will be equally good in both bikes, but the pedal kickback on the Megatower on big hits will be slightly less than that of the Ransom. This is a good thing as you, the rider, won't have to fight against the pedal movement quite as much, and the chain forces will have slightly less effect on the suspension movement. So what's my overall summary of the VPP suspension and the Santa Cruz Megatower in particular? Firstly, the suspension will react very little when braking in most situations, and is better than that of the 4-bar linkage. Unfortunately, if braking immediately after bigger hits, this VPP design won't resist rising at all, while the 4-bar will still likely be somewhat composed due to a higher anti-rise. Secondly, the anti-squat of the suspension design is excellent and near 100% in almost all situations in which you're likely to pedal, which is great as the pedal bob will be almost non-existent. However, this is also comparable to the 4-bar I looked at previously for the Ransom, so nothing noteworthy here. Thirdly, the suspension force versus travel is also almost identical to that of the 4-bar linkage, which I find extremely surprising. I really thought that the VPP would have some interesting characteristic that would greatly differentiate it from the 4-bar, but turns out in my analysis, the difference is negligible. Finally, the wheel path is also almost the same as the 4-bar, while the chain growth is about 1% less than it. All this leads me to conclude that the VPP suspension used in the Santa Cruz Megatower, while an excellent suspension, might not be worth the hype, and that I personally wouldn't buy a Megatower based on suspension alone. It also reinforced the point that one of the most important things to do when shopping for a new bike is to make sure it fits your body dimensions well, and that you feel comfortable on it, before you get sold on a particular manufacturer based solely on suspension design. So, finally the big question, why do you pay so much for a Santa Cruz? Well, in my opinion, it's likely the excellent craftsmanship, after-sales care, and possibly better components on the bike. Thanks again for joining me this week, and hope you enjoyed the video. If you like what I'm doing on this channel, please make sure to subscribe and like the video. And if you want to support me, you can find me on Patreon, or click on Ways to Support on my website. All links are provided down below. Until next time, happy trails!